Penguin Random House Audio presents The Massacre of Mankind, a sequel to The War of the Worlds by H.G. Wells, by Stephen Baxter. Read for you by Nathalie Buscombe. To H.G. Wells, this extending of his idea and the H.G. Wells Society. If astronomy teaches anything, it teaches that man is but a detail in the evolution of the universe, and that resemblant, though diverse, details are inevitably to be expected in the host of orbs around him. He learns that, though he will probably never find his double anywhere, he is destined to find any number of cousins scattered through space. Percival Lowell, Mars, 1985. It seemed to me that humanity was on the verge of a deep apprehension of its place in the cosmos. The intellectual world was alive with speculation and hope. Then, the Martians came again. Walter Jenkins, Narratives of the Martian Wars, 1913 and 1928. Book 1. The Return of the Martians. Chapter 1. A Call to Arms. To those of us who survived it, the first Martian war of the early 20th century was a cataclysm. And yet, to minds far greater than our own and older even than the Martians, minds who regard our world from the cold outer reaches of space, that conflict must have seemed a trivial affair indeed, and unworthy. The further a world is from the sun, the older it must be, and cooler. Thus the Earth is older than hot, fecund Venus, and Mars, austere and chill, is in turn older than our temperate globe. The outer worlds, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune, are ancient indeed and locked in the stasis of time and ice. But Jupiter, king of planets, more massive than the rest combined, older than Mars, as Mars is older than our world, and warmed by its own inner fire, is, must be, host to the gravest intellects of all. We know now that these Jovian minds have long watched us, watched humanity, the Martians, even innocent Venus. What can they have thought of our war? The fragile sparks crossing the night, the flares of fire on the green skin of our planet, the splash of ink-black smoke, the swarming and helpless populations. The Jovians looked on all this as a silent god might regard his flawed creations, perhaps, their reflections unimaginable, their disapproval profound. And yet, claims Walter Jenkins, that great chronicler of the First War, this cosmic scrutiny provides the context within which we, who once believed we were lords of creation, must live out our petty lives. Walter was right. This mighty context was to shape everything about the Second War, and indeed the most important moment of my own life. On the other hand, I myself, like most people, stay sane by generally not thinking about it. And speaking of grave scrutiny, as I commence this memoir of my own, I cannot help but acknowledge the long shadow cast by that tombstone of a volume, which everyone knows as the Narrative, the History of the First War, penned by Walter, my esteemed brother-in-law, if he can still be termed such after I divorced Frank, his brother. A work that, as Walter's therapist Freud might say, has burned a particular perception of the First Martian War into the public subconscious with the intensity of a heat ray. Let me warn the reader from the off that if it's the grandeur of the cosmos that you want, all told in the lofty prose of a man who was once paid to scribble such stuff, then it's another correspondent you should seek out. On the other hand, if it's an honest, factual account of my own experience you're after, a woman who survived the First Martian War and had her life pulled to pieces in the second, then I humbly submit this, History as I saw it. Although I admit it is an irony that my experience of the second conflict should begin, long before a Martian again set foot on this Earth, with a complicated series of telephone calls from Walter himself, emanating from a hospital in Vienna. I, who was patiently building a fresh life for myself in the new world, wanted nothing to do with it. But I have always had a sense of duty. I answered the summons. a dotty house, to Jupiter. From the beginning, it was a tangled tale indeed. Chapter 2. A Meeting of Veterans. My first inkling of the impending storm came, in fact, in New York, specifically at the Woolworth Building, where Major Eric Eden, retired, asked to meet me, in order, he said, to relay a message from Walter Jenkins. My young colleague, Harry Kane, insisted on accompanying me. Harry was of that breed of brash American journalists who are always suspicious of all things European. He would have been even before the Schlieffen War, I think. I suppose Harry came as a kind of moral support, but with a professional curiosity too about a Martian war that, to him, had been only a distant spectacle of his youth. So, we made our way. It was a brisk mid-March day in the year 1920. Manhattan had suffered what everybody hoped would prove to be the last snowstorm of the year, although the main hazard on that particular morning turned out to be the slush piles alongside every sidewalk, ever ready to soak an unwary ankle. I remember that morning, the swarming, cheerfully ill-tempered traffic, the electric advertising hoardings that glowed in the greyness of the day, the sheer innocent vigor of a young nation, in those last hours and minutes before I was dragged back into the affairs of gloomy, wounded old England. At last, Harry and I pushed through the doors into the Woolworth. The air in the lobby, heated and scented, hit me like a slap in the face. In those days, the Americans liked to be very warm indoors. I pulled open my coat and loosened my headscarf, and we walked across a floor of polished Greek marble that was speckled with melted snow and grit from the street. The lobby was busy. Harry, with his usual air of amused detachment, an attractive trait in a man a few years younger than me, even if it doesn't sound it, said to me over the noise, "I take it your Major Eden doesn't know the city so well." "You can say that without ever meeting him."
"Sure I can. Where else would you set up a meeting but here? In London, an American would meet you at St. Paul's. That's the one with a hole in the dome, right? And a British in New York." "Well, here we are, in the tallest building in the world," he pointed. "And there he is, by the way."
The man he indicated stood alone. He was slim, not tall, and wore a morning suit that looked expensive enough but dowdy compared to the peacock fashions around him. If this was Eden, he looked younger than his 38 years, 6 years older than me. And that must be Eden because
he's the only one looking at the artwork.
Indeed, the man was staring up at the ceiling, which, had I ever noticed this before, was coated with mosaics that looked Roman, perhaps Byzantine. That was the Americans for you. In this new monument to a triumphant mammon, they felt the need to reach back to their detached European past. Harry strode across the floor, muttering.
"And could he look more the Englishman abroad?
If this is the best he can do to blend into the background, no wonder the Martians caught him."
That made me snort with laughter as I followed.
"Hush, you're terrible. The man's a hero."
Eric Eden was, after all, the only living human being who had actually been inside a functioning Martian cylinder. He was captured in the first couple of days in 07, as the military, in their ignorance, probed at the first landing pit at Woking. Having been kept alive, perhaps as a specimen for later examination, Eric had fought his way out of a space cylinder with nothing much more than his bare hands, and had ultimately made it back to his unit with invaluable information on Martian technology. Hero or not, Eric looked rather nervous as we bore down on him.
"Mrs. Jenkins, I take it."
"I prefer Miss Elphinstone, actually, since my divorce."
"My apologies. I imagine you recognize me from the posters in the bookshop windows."
Harry grinned.
"Something like that." "It has been a well-announced tour. Just Bert Cook and myself for now, but we should be joining up with old Schiaparelli in Boston, discoverer of the canals, you know, in his 80s, but going strong."
I introduced Harry quickly. "We both work for the Post."
"I've not read your book, sir," Harry admitted. "It's kind of out of my sphere. I spend my time fighting Tammany Hall as opposed to men from Mars."
Eric looked baffled, and I felt moved to interpret.
"Tammany Hall's the big Democrat political machine in the city. Americans do everything on a heroic scale, including corruption. And they were not men in that cylinder, Harry."
"However," Harry went on, unabashed, "I've been known to dabble in the book trade myself. Sensational potboilers. That's my line, not having a heroic past to peddle.
Be glad of that, Eric said, softly enough. A line which seemed to me the embodiment of British understatement. Miss Elphinstone, Walter Jenkins did warn me of your likely...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.